worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is he. Sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat.
Worthy is the Lamb.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is he. Sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Clothed in rainbows of living color, flashes of lightning, rolls of thunder. Blessing and honor, strength and glory and power be to you, the only wise King. Oh, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Filled with wonder, awestruck wonder, at the mention of your name. Jesus, your name is power, is breath and living water, such a marvelous mystery. Oh, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. And I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you.
Jesus, Lamb of God, or you are my all in all.
My strength when I am weak, you are the treasure that I seek. You are my all in all. Seeking you as a precious jewel, Lord, to give up I'd be a fool. You are my all in all. God.
taking my sin, my cross, my shame. Rising again, I bless your name. You are my all in all. When I fall down, you pick me up. When I am dry, you fill my cup. You are my all in all. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Jesus, Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Let's sing Holy, Holy, Holy. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, early in the morning our song shall rise to thee. The darkness hide thee, though the eye of sinful man thy glory may not see.
This is the beginning of Holy Week. So this is the beginning of in Christianity, what we call the Passion Week, the week of suffering for Jesus. And Holy Week began with Palm Sunday, with the triumphal entry of Jesus into Jerusalem. And so we're going to look at the version of that story today that is in Matthew chapter 21. So if you want to turn to Matthew chapter 21, and we'll be looking at, you know, the first few stories really there in Matthew chapter 21, trying to get an understanding. It says, as they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with a colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, tell him that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away. This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. Say to the daughter of Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt, placed their cloaks on them, and Jesus sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of them and those that followed shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" The crowds answered, "This is Jesus the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." So let's pause there. I want us to look at this first story. So we've got this idea that Jesus now has a throng of people, a multitude of people who are coming to him, who are following him, and they've been tracking with him. We learn from the Gospel of Luke, they've been tracking with him to go all the way up to Jerusalem. And this is the Feast of Passover. So they, as they're coming into Jerusalem, they would have been singing things like what we read this morning earlier, Psalm 118. They would have been doing Psalm 113, 14, 15, 16, 17, and 18 as they're going there up to Jerusalem. The hills of the songs of ascent. And ordinarily, so this passage is packed with messages about Jesus. It's full of all kinds of images that if you've got a trained eye, you can see. And I'm going to try to pull them out. It's like artwork. So as they're getting there to the Mount of Olives, getting ready to go into Jerusalem, what would normally happen, if I remember correctly, I think Gordon Hugenberger, a teacher I used to have, said this. What would normally happen, you get to the ascent of the Mount of Olives, and if you've been riding an animal, you get off. And some people would even get on their knees and crawl the rest of the way into the city of Jerusalem. This sign of deep humility as you're coming into Jerusalem. So in this passage, what's shocking is that Jesus does the opposite. As Jesus is getting ready to come into Jerusalem, he doesn't get off of the animal. He doesn't get on his knees to crawl into Jerusalem. He says, "Go and get a donkey." Or two donkeys in this passage. Why? What's the meaning of the donkey? You know, we know, because I mean it's stressed a lot of times in church services, that Jesus is coming in humility, right? This is a humble animal. This is an animal that's different from maybe a war horse, a white steed. And there is some truth to that, right? It's quoted in the prophet Zechariah. You know, he's going to come meek, humble, lowly, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. So there is humility in this. But what we're missing frequently is the majesty. The donkey was a very important animal in Israelite and in Jewish understanding. Going all the way back to Genesis, I think it's chapter 49, where Jacob is dying and he blesses his sons with different blessings. And when he blesses Judah, he says, "You're going to be the line of the kings," basically. "The scepter will not depart from you until it comes to the one to whom it's due. And you will tie up your donkey." He mentions the donkey of Judah that is associated with kingship. Later on in the book of Judges, we're told that the 70 sons of Gideon used to ride around judging Israel, or ruling Israel as it were, on donkeys. How many of you remember the story of Solomon? When David died, he passed the kingdom to his son Solomon. But at first what had happened is that it was going to somebody else, and Bathsheba came in and she appealed to David. "Look, the kingdom's supposed to go to Solomon. What do we do?" And so David said, "This is what we do. Go take Solomon, anoint him as king, and put him on my mule, and parade him around town." The sign of kingship. And as Jesus comes in, one of the things that they do is they take their garments. Some people grab these palm branches, right? Other people, if they didn't have palm branches, they grabbed their coats, their cloaks, and they took them and they put them underneath the feet of the donkey as Jesus is riding into Jerusalem. Now, as you can imagine, for poor people, and a lot of the people at that time were poor, this might have been their only cloak. I mean, this is like taking your one suit today and saying, okay, here you go. I'm going to put it under the donkey. But it's also imagery of kingship. In the book of 2 Kings, there's a story from the prophet Elisha where there's a ruling king in Israel, and Elisha says, that king's not going to be ruling anymore. And he tells one of his servants, I want you to go, and I want you to find Jehu, and in a secret room, get him away from everybody, and I want you to anoint him as the new king of Israel. So that servant of the prophet goes, and he does that. He anoints Jehu as the new king of Israel. This is a coup, a God-ordained coup. And then Jehu comes out into the open, and his friends say, what happened in there? Tell us exactly what happened. And Jehu says, I was anointed the king of Israel. And what do you think they did? They took their cloaks, they took their garments, and they put them under Jehu. So when we read about this imagery of Jesus coming in on a donkey, Jesus coming in, people putting their garments under him, if you are an ancient Israelite reader, you know this is how you talk about a king coming into town, and a new king. They're coming out with these palm branches to welcome him in. And that's what you used to do when a king had taken over a city. So imagine a king has come in, and there's this enemy king, and you were part of the enemy king territory, maybe. But now the new king has come in, and he's conquered, and he's coming into the city. So what do? To show that you're welcoming him in as your new king? You take palm branches out, and you wave them. And that's your way of saying, come on in. You can be, you be our king. We're surrendering to you. Kingship and humility. Jesus is the triumphant king coming in terms of peace. He's coming in terms of peace. A part of the way that this passage is described would have reminded the Jewish readers of something that happened 200 years before in the days of the Maccabees. In the days of the Maccabees, the temple had been taken over by a foreign power. And the Maccabees had fought against the foreign power that had taken over God's temple and desecrated it. Antiochus Epiphanes had come in, and he had slaughtered a pig and offered it in God's temple. Think about that. Imagine what an insult, what a sacrilege, what blasphemy that is. Antiochus had offered a pig. And if I remember correctly, he'd offered it to Zeus on God's altar. Well, the Maccabees fought against Antiochus and his armies, and they won. And when they came in terms of peace with these foliage branches. So it's as though saying Jesus is the new conqueror, and he's coming in terms of peace. That's the first thing I want us to see. The second thing, Jesus is the conquering Lord coming to purify his temple. In the story of the Maccabees, 200 years before Jesus, As soon as Simon Maccabeus got into Jerusalem, what do you think was the first thing he did? He purified the temple, the place that had been desecrated with the swine's blood. He purified it. So when we read about Jesus, as soon as he gets into Jerusalem, appearing at the temple, as prophesied in Malachi chapter 3, to purify it, this is language saying, this is the new ruler, and he's coming to purify. But how do you think you would have felt if you were one of the Jewish leaders? Right? It's one thing to purify a temple after Antiochus IV has offered a pig on the altar. But what if you're a Jewish leader over the temple at the time, and then Jesus comes in to basically purify the temple? What's he saying about you? What's he saying about the religious establishment? Let's look at this. Matthew chapter 21 and then verse 12. Jesus entered the temple area and drove out all who were buying and selling there. He overturned the tables of the money changers and the benches of those selling doves. It is written, he said to them, my house will be called a house of prayer, but you are making it a den of robbers. The blind and the lame came to him at the temple, and he healed them. But when the chief priests and the teachers of the law saw the wonderful things he did, and the children shouting in the temple area, Hosanna to the Son of David, they were indignant. Do you hear what these children are saying? They asked him. Yes, replied Jesus. Have you never read, from the lips of children and infants, you have ordained praise? And he left them and went out of the city to Bethany, where he spent the night. Okay, so what's happening here in this story of the cleansing of the temple? So it appears that at that time, what was going on is the temple precinct, it was a very large compound, and there were different courts in the precinct, and there was the court of the men, there was the court of the women, there was the court of the Gentiles, non-Jews that wanted to worship God, and they would go up to the court of the Gentiles. Well, what the religious establishment had done is they had taken that court of the Gentiles, the place where the Gentiles would worship, and they had turned it into a market. You know, it was hard to bring an animal from very far, right? Imagine that you're on pilgrimage and you want to go up to Jerusalem. Well, it's going to be hard for you to bring that lamb, that goat, that bull for hundreds and hundreds of miles, right? So what do? You get there and you buy it at the temple. And then you've turned it into a den of robbers. So he goes in to overturn the tables of the money changers. He goes in to overturn the tables of the money changers. Now, when Jesus uses this language of den of robbers, he's hearkening back to the prophet Jeremiah. The prophet Jeremiah had said something like that about, you know, 600 years earlier, something like that, 650 years earlier. Jeremiah had said, you guys, this is supposed to be a place of worship, but you're taking advantage of people in it. You're using the temple not to be a blessing to God, but to be a curse to other people. And you're saying God will never bring judgment on this place. You're saying God will always protect Jerusalem against its adversaries. You go into the temple and you say, God is here, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord. And Jeremiah says to them, you've made it a den of robbers, a den of thieves, where you take advantage of others and you think you can hide out in this cave and be safe. And Jeremiah then prophesied the destruction of Jerusalem. So when Jesus comes in and overturns the tables and says, it's a den of robbers again, the scary thing behind that is, it's a way of prophesying, which Jesus then later does, that Jerusalem will be overturned again, which it was 40 years later to the Romans, and the temple was destroyed. Jesus comes in as the Lord. But the first order of business that he has in the temple and the first order of business that he has in our lives, if we are going to really embrace Jesus as King, the first thing he's going to do in our hearts is he's going to purify us. He's going to say, what are the activities in your life that need to be turned over? Don't say, well, because I'm following Jesus, I'm safe. No. Except what he's doing in your heart. Accept what he's doing in your life. Allow him to turn over the money-changing tables of the heart. Number three, the final passage we're looking at today. Verse 18, early in the morning, as he was on his way back to the city, he was hungry. Seeing a fig tree by the road, he went up to it, but found nothing on it except leaves. Then he said to it, may you never bear fruit again. Immediately the tree withered. When the disciples saw this, they were amazed. How did the fig tree wither so quickly? They asked. Jesus replied, I tell you the truth, if you have faith and do not doubt, not only can you do what was done to the fig tree, but also you can say of this mountain, go, throw yourself into the sea and it will be done. If you believe, you will receive whatever you ask for in prayer. Now this is one of those classically confusing passages, right? Why is Jesus angry at a fig tree. Well, the fig tree was symbolic of the nation of Israel. And it was symbolic of the hypocrisy of the time. Matthew tells us that the tree had leaves on it. In other words, it looked like it should have fruit. To the passerby, you would see that tree and you would say, okay, there's something good there. There's something desirable there. I can be fed there. I can be nourished there. But the closer you got to that tree, the more you realized it was like a cloud without rain. It was an empty bucket. There was nothing on there. It was a hypocrite of a tree. So when Jesus goes up to the tree, and yeah, it looks like it should be really fruitful and good, but there's actually no fruit on it. He curses it, and it's a picture of what's happening to the hypocrisy of his time. Jesus is saying this whole system in which everything looks good. People are going up to the temple to worship. They're coming here in multitudes. It's like a tree with leaves that has no fruit, and it's going to be taken away. No one will eat from you ever again. So what's our response? How do we respond to these messages on Palm Sunday? Number one, do we receive the King of Peace, and do we receive him peacefully? Are we going out with palm branches? Are we laying down our coats, our cloaks under him? Are we saying, yes, this is exactly what I want. Come and rule and reign. Number two, are we really ready for that? Because the first thing he's going to start doing when we do that is he's going to start purifying. He's going to start turning over the money tables in our lives. He's going to start saying, okay, you were involved in this before, but now that I'm here, it's over. Get out. He's going to say that to the sin in our lives, to the hypocrisy in our lives. Are we ready for that? Or are we going to resist? And finally, are we going to be a fig tree that actually bears fruit? That actually has fruit in keeping with repentance, as John the Baptist might have said? Or are we going to be content to look good on the outside? We wear our nice clothes when we go to church or wherever we go. But on the inside, there's no fruit. Are we willing to allow God to do the kinds of things in our lives that make us fruitful people so that others can eat from us? Let's pray. Father, I pray that you will help us to embrace Christ as King on this Palm Sunday. I thank you for Holy Week. This is such an important week in which the truth of the gospel was revealed and who Jesus is was revealed. May we grasp it. May we seize it. May we submit to it and to him. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So this is also Passover week. Passover, I think, starts on the 8th. And one of the major themes in, especially like the Gospel of John, is Jesus as the Lamb. And you'll notice that we have been singing songs in line with that today. Jesus is